There we go. So welcome. This is the 8:05 meeting, and we are going to discuss several documents that will help you understand this program a little better and some of the requirements of the program. So the first document that I'm going to show you how to get to, number one, and then kind of show you a little bit of what's in it, is the Graduate Field Experience Manual. So I'm going to share my screen here. And this manual is available on the Grand Canyon website. And there's two, the website for Grand Canyon has changed a little bit. If you were a previous graduate student, it may look a little different to you. It changed over maybe about 3 months ago. So this may look a little different. So there is a kind of an internal and an external facing website for GCU. So when you look at this, you want to make sure you go to students.gcu.edu. That's where you're going to start to locate this document. But that's the website that you need to start at. And then on the right side, you're going to click onto academics, and you're going to go into College of Nursing and Healthcare Professions. You're going to click on that, and then you're going to scroll down a little bit. And then you're going to see OFE, which stands for Office of Field Experience, Connecting Classroom Theory to Real Life Experience. And down there, you're going to go to Guidelines for Graduate Field Experiences. So just to recap, students.gcu.edu is the website. On the right side, you're going to click on Academics. You're going to go to the College of Nursing. And then you're going to scroll down, and it'll say OFE, Connecting Classroom Theory to Real Life Experience. And you're going to click on the Guidelines for Graduate Field Experiences. Now, this is a very long document. I can't see the page numbers on here, but I think it's over 100. I know that. So this has all of our graduate and doctoral programs. So what you need to focus on, you go all the way down to page 90. To find DNP program. So starts on page 90, section 11. And this is going to discuss not only our program, but it kind of discusses a little bit of the background of what a DNP is and what a DPI, Direct Practice Improvement Project, looks like. So take a look at this. There's also more sites on here that you can click on that talks about the DNP degree, how did we get here, what does it look like, and then it goes into all of the student learning outcomes. These are all basically will look very familiar to you by the end of this program. These are all your domains and competencies that you are going to be examining throughout this program. And then we look into the purpose of practice immersion experience. It talks all about what practice immersion looks like. So take the time to look at this document. It is worth it. This has a lot of valuable information for you moving forward in the program. It talks about TIFON, talks about case logs, which we're also going to look into. And so take a look at that. Programmatic assessments talks about your reflective journals and all of those things. So take a look at that very important document. I would highly suggest that you do not print this document out because it is a fluid document. So the reason we have it in this area on this site is because it is updated probably monthly. Now, are there very dramatic updates? Usually there are not dramatic updates. But I would hate for you to print it out and then something changes and you have the old document. So my suggestion and my own habit is to bookmark it. You have it bookmarked. You can open it frequently. And it is a document that you do want to check frequently for changes. Now, if there are any significant changes in the program, I will make sure and communicate typically by email. We are now, Dr. Logue is your dean, and we are now doing monthly to quarterly. I think we're going to change it to quarterly emails from the dean. And so that goes directly to DNP students, and that is usually my voice as well. So that talks about any program updates, anything that we have seen a need to communicate to our students. Along those lines is also, we also have graduate town hall meetings that are student meetings. And those are, I want to say, every third Tuesday of every month, and you're also invited to go to those. I attend all of those and am able to answer any questions along those lines of communication. But anyway, if there's any changes in this document that are significant, it will be communicated to you, but it is your responsibility as a student to review this document in depth and know your program requirements. Okay, so I'm gonna move on from that. And anyone on video, if you could please go off video, I am recording, and we will have a chance to answer questions at the end of the presentation. Okay, and so let's move into Typhon. Typhon is one of those areas that students can find very confusing, but once you understand that we're not using all of the components that are that Typhon can use, it's really not that difficult. So let me show you some things in Typhon. I'm going to share my screen again to what Typhon looks like here. Okay, and so for Typhon, actually let me back up a little bit to two things. Let me back up here before I get to Typhon. I'm going to share how to get a mentor in first. So you were actually sent this as an email communication. But this is how you get your site and mentor and or content expert when you get into your project courses. This is how you get them approved. This is the process. Why I sent it out in email communication is because the process used to be that your faculty approved them. Things were not going as smoothly as I would have liked for that process. And so we changed it over a little bit to this process. And really, it's in your hands as far as getting all of the information to Office of Field Experience. So if you look at this document, it will show you, provide all this information to this website or to this email, dnp.ofe@gcu.edu. And it has the mentor CV or resume, mentor's nursing, current nursing license or online verification, site information, site education coordinator's name and contact information. So you would send that over to OFE, and then they put it into Typhon, and then basically weekly, they send me that information. I will review all of your mentor and content experts' CV and all of those things and make sure they're appropriate for the program of study. So that is the process, and then you will be notified, and you'll be able to see your mentor in Typhon to be able to log your case logs under them. So that's the process, the current process. So with practice immersion hours, a couple very, very important concepts with practice immersion hours. The first thing is that it needs to be in a clinical site. This is a clinical program, meaning if you are faculty, that's okay, but you still have to have a clinical component to where you are doing your practice immersion hours. So whether that's a community center, whether that is on your university site, if you have a wellness center, something like that where you have access to a clinical arena. This is not a DNP with educational emphasis, which may pull in that faculty piece. Right now, this program is related to clinical components. So I want to make sure that that is very clear. So sites that are just a university site that is not linked to a clinical component would not be appropriate. And that also will lead into when we talk about these direct project improvement, direct practice improvement projects. So your practice immersion hours. These are basically, this is how I can describe that to you, because I know it seems kind of gray on what a practice immersion hour is. So your assignments, I'm gonna share my screen again here for you. This is, please mute your phones if you're on the phone, please. So I'm sharing this screen here. I'm sharing this screen here that shows practice immersion hours. These are this little couple paragraphs here are after assignments that you can include as your practice immersion hours. So what I'm showing for those of you on the phone, it's after the assignment directions, and it basically says portfolio practice hours. It may be possible to earn these hours for the case report or whatever the assignment is. Enter the following after the references section of your paper. And it says, I insert your name, verify I've completed so many hours in association with the goals and objectives for this assignment. So any assignment that has this statement in the assignment directions, you can use towards practice immersion hours. So what does that look like? So say I'm doing a paper in your genetics class that is on, I wrote on Alzheimer's disease. And with that, I write the paper, I spend the time researching scholarly articles, I write that paper, I put this underneath the paper, or in the paper at the very end saying, this is what I did. And in my clinical practice day, I see patients every Friday still, in my clinical practice day, I am utilizing the domains, the competencies, all of the knowledge that I gained from that written assignment, and I'm using that, I'm translating that, I'm immersing that into my clinical practice so that when I have a patient with Alzheimer's disease, I can say, are they appropriate for genetic testing? Or I could talk to them about different genetic testing, those types of things. So that's that translation of that assignment into clinical practice. That's what that looks like. So so that, again, is another of the reason that you need to have a clinical site to be able to do those practice immersion hours, because that's really the purpose of this doctoral program. DNP is much different than research, because DNP, if you can keep this sentence in your mind, you are translating existing current guidelines or knowledge or literature, okay, into clinical practice to improve patient outcomes. So you're translating existing knowledge which can be guidelines, research that's out there, translating that into clinical practice to improve patient outcomes. That's the purpose of a DNP. Very different than a PhD-focused degree. PhD is generating new research. They're trying to create new research. So we're identifying the gap that why is, my project was based on Beer's criteria. Any of you in geriatrics know Beer's criteria is a list of over 53 medications that should not be prescribed in the elderly population. But we're still doing it. And what are the outcomes? Our patients are falling and they're miserable and they are delirious and all of these things from all these meds we keep prescribing them that we know are not effective and actually harmful. So when you take something that you know, there's the gap, right? Why is that a gap? So you take that guideline and you implement it. Okay, we are going to implement this Beer's criteria. We're not going to prescribe. And did it change patient outcomes? Did we have less of these things? So that gives you an example of what a DPI, Direct Practice Improvement Project, looks like. You want to find a gap in knowledge, or I'm sorry, a gap in practice, basically, clinical practice that you see in your arena that you want to change. Why aren't we using this guideline? Why aren't we using this criteria to improve these patient outcomes? And so that's what you would be implementing. We all know it takes more than 16 years to get our best practices, our evidence-based practice, into clinical practice. Why is that? So that's why DNP degrees and DNPs are so important, is to get that across. Okay, I'll go off my rampage with that, but it's really exciting because this profession can really change patient outcomes. All right, moving along. We are going to go into Typhon now. Let me pull this screen up for you. Let's see. Okay. So this is what your Typhon will look like. I only have it in administrative view, so I can't put one in for you, but I'll show you a couple of things. So you are only going to log case logs. You're not going to do anything with time logs at all. So you're going to do case logs only. And remember, your case logs are reflecting your assignments that you just did that you translated into clinical practice. So most of these assignments will be about 10 hours, most of them. Some of your case studies in week 7, you'll have pretty laborious case studies. Some of those you could probably even go up to 20 hours. But these are actual hours. So if you spend 11, if you spent 15, then that's what is what you would want to document. But on average, you can kind of count on about 10 hours for each assignment, and that would be translated into your case log in Typhon. So you will only use case logs. Now remember, we're not documenting on individual patients. That is not the purpose of this program. So that can be kind of a mentality shift for a lot of you that are advanced practice and maybe have used Typhon in the past and used to logging every single patient. That's not what this looks like. So on average, if there's an assignment that has that practice portfolio hour statement, you'll have about one case log a week related to that assignment and that translation into clinical practice. So you're only using case logs, and I'm going to try to pull up a sample case log entry. So this is what it would look like. So remember, your course will change every time. DNP 805, where you're at right now, will be your course support, of course. Your preceptor will be your mentor. We use terminology mentor for the doctoral program. And then once you get into your project courses, you'll have a content expert. Patient demographics, we have just chosen to use the standard 1 year age, gender, male for every single patient. Because remember, we're not doing individual patient care or logs. So age 1 year, gender, male. And then your time with patient, that 10 hours translates into 600 minutes. So that's where they're getting this time with patients, 600 minutes. And you will never have consults with preceptor. Consulting with your mentor does not accumulate practice immersion hours. That's just a discussion. It has to be true clinical work to actually get that time with the patient. So anything you put in consult with preceptor will not go towards your final practice immersion hour. So you really want to keep that blank. So only time with patient is where you will be accumulating your practice immersion hours. The next section says procedure skills. And what you'll find in there are all your domains and competencies. So these will become, it seems like a lot right now, you will have these memorized by the end of this program. They will become very familiar with you, and you can just pop in the ones that you use for that assignment and that clinical experience. So that's where that goes. Procedure skills, you're going to list all of your domains and competencies. Then the next section is what type of evidence was used. Typically, it's scholarly references, scholarly sources, literature, something like that. Most of the time, you're going to have a practice problem identified, and you are going to resolve it. Because a lot of your papers, that's what you're talking about, especially your case studies. Your case studies, you're identifying a problem, and then you're identifying a solution. And then clinical notes section, you're going to want to put five sentences or so regarding the assignment that you completed, that you wrote about. So for the one I was discussing earlier, wrote about Alzheimer's disease related to APOE genetic system, and so on and so on. So maybe about five sentences describing the actual topic that you discussed in your assignment. I've seen some students put in their epidemiology paper. That's not appropriate. I really want you to discuss a couple sentences that you actually wrote on, okay? So that's eventually what your case log will look like. That's it. That is the extent of that piece of the case log. The other components to Typhon are placing some of your documents into external documents. Some examples of that would be your ISP. Some examples of that would be your reflective journal. And the reflective journal, just as a side note, there is a template in the DC network, which I'll show you in DC network. I'll show you where that's at, actually. I'm going to show you DC network, and that'll be a good example. Let's see, reflective journal, ISP, your case report, which is usually your week 7, and then your final mentor state or your final type on statement, which says, I completed a total of whatever, 50 hours for this course. So those are some examples of things that would, external documents that would go into that external section in Typon. See if I can see it on my, yeah, right here. So here is external documents in Typon. That's where you would click on that and then enter those documents. All right, so that's Typon in a nutshell. The most important things to remember to review is you're only entering case logs, not time logs. You are entering it into time with patient, not consult with preceptor. You want to make sure that you enter, five or so sentences in the clinical notes section about your actual assignment that you completed. Okay. So let's go ahead and go into DC Network. Let me pull that up. Okay, so this is what DC Network looks like. If you haven't been to DC Network yet, try it out today, because this is a great communication spot. It has a lot of resources for you, as well as a question and answer forum that is available only to doctoral students. So this DC Network, it's Doctoral Community Network is what that stands for. And you have your own, so you have education, PhD, DBA, and then DNP community is on the right side there. You would click that, and this opens up your area. So just some things to note at the very top here next to home, you have Q&A. And this is where students can pose questions, even professors, faculty can pose questions. I highly recommend, if it's a new question, to post a new Q&A. There's some old, before I was in this position, there's some old Q&A on there that I'm not linked to, so I don't get them right away. I kind of have to search for them. So if you have a new question, you can click on that, and I receive an email that there's somebody asking a question in here, and I try to do my best to respond within 24 hours. So here's an example of a student who had a question about 820, and then my response to her. So that's what that looks like. Please feel free to utilize that. It's a great tool, and usually if you're having a question, you know your classmates are as well. So that's one tool, and that may be a tool that you use after you've already addressed something with your faculty and you need clarification, or something that you're trying to find in the DC network that you're unable to find. So that's question and answer, Q&A. So I'm going to go back to home, and right in the middle here, you will see DNP program documents. This is the main area that you'll be utilizing for resources. You would click on that, and then what I've recently developed are folders. There's a lot of other things in here, but the other titles, they're still in here because they're linked, hyperlinked into classrooms, so I cannot delete those. But all of that information are put into the folders. So your best route is to go click on DNP 805, and then here's some resources for you. ISP, how do you do an ISP? Here's an example. Here's a student document. Here's the example. Reflective journals and instructions. This was the one I was telling you about. So here's an optional journal template that you could use for your reflective journal and the instructions. So take a look at this when you have a moment and review this. This, you know, talks about anything that you would be related to DNP 805. The other nice thing about this is if you're kind of curious of what that literature review looks like in 820, you can click on that 820 and just kind of see what 10 strategic points, all of those things look like. Some of these have duplicates in them, but it's only duplicated if you do it in that course as well. So take a look at that, a really great resource. It has some of the course documents, some of the templates, but it also has other resources such as DNP 830 is your statistics class. I put a whole section in here related to methodology. So there's PowerPoints to help assist students on deciding what kind of methodology they would like to use. So take a look at that when you have a moment. The other section in the DC network that I just started utilizing is the DNP tips and announcements. And this is a blog written by myself that just kind of tells you any updates. And of course, the best update I had was that 26 of our students are graduating in October. So I'm pretty excited about that. And it also gives you a link to the Graduate Field Experience Guidelines Manual that we just went over earlier today. So that will be updated frequently as well, and that's another source of communication to you. So definitely take a look at this. It's dc.gcu.edu is the main site. And take a look at that at your convenience. And if you have questions, you're free to contact me with those. So that's the DC network. The last thing I wanted to go over before I open it up for questions is the actual project. This is available. Let's see, here we go. So I'm going to share this. This is a PowerPoint that I put together for students and faculty so that we're all on the same page as far as what a direct practice improvement project looks like. This is available, I believe, in 805 and 801 folders in the DC network for you to review. This is just going to tell you a little bit about the recommendations for the project. So we have NOMP, and then we have the AACN, the DNP Essentials, that kind of guides our practice. Those are the two main recommendations that we have, and those are also based on our CCNE accreditation. So that's why these are so important to understand, because we have to follow these guidelines for our programmatic requirements. So according to, and NOMP is very similar to the DNP Essentials, the AACN. They basically use the same language. But take a look at this PowerPoint. I won't go through it slide for slide. I'm just going to kind of highlight a few things. So the project is related to advanced, this is from NOMP. The project is related to advanced practice in nursing specialty, benefits a population, group, or community rather than an individual patient. So that's something to think about with your projects. You're looking for a population. Like mine was geared towards the geriatric population. And I'll tell you from, acquiring this degree, it has really broadened my view on my patients as far as, looking at, and for those of you who don't know, I'm a nurse practitioner. So when I used to think about patients, it was, how can I help this one patient? What can I do individually for them? Which is great. Then when you get this degree, you have a much broader thought process of how can I help this population? What can I do to have the more of an effect on this complete population? So it's a little bit of a thought change, and you may find that as you go along in the practice, in the program. So this project often arises from clinical practice. It can be done in partnership with another entity. And they talk about clinical agency, a school, health department, church, government, voluntary organization, community group, that type of thing. One thing you want to think about is feasibility. So I know you're early. This is your second course, and I have no doubt this is completely overwhelming. So I apologize for that. I know this is knowledge overload, but what's nice is you can start developing your project based on these recommendations. But something to think about is your site. So you want something that's feasible. Feasible meaning if it is a large organization, perhaps a hospital organization that you're looking into, do they have their own IRB? You know, an IRB could limit you on your time frame. Some IRBs meet every 3 months. So that's something to think about. And then think about your stakeholders, right? Are your stakeholders interested in your project? I know when I started my project, I went to my stakeholders and said, are you interested in this? Because once you have stakeholders that are interested in your project, you will get a lot more assistance and not meet much resistance because you're all on the same page working synergistically. Project leadership may be solo or collaborative depending on scope of project and university requirements. Our requirements right now are that you do a solo project. The purpose of the DNP is to illustrate that you understand the domains and competencies and understand that project process. So if you were to have somebody else involved, we want to make sure you understand data collection, that you understand data analysis and conclusion and future implications, those types of things. Scholarly project address identified needs. So you're thinking, think of your PICO question, right? What are the gaps? What are the gaps in literature? When you do a search on the library on one of your potential topics, what comes up? Is there a lot of literature or are there three studies? You probably want to pick something that has a lot of literature supporting what your potential intervention may be. So you want something that you're going to identify as gaps. And then, again, literature review suggests an evidence base for the project or supports the need for the project. Description of the innovation is adequate for others to use, essential components for success, cost, etc. And again, this is that feasibility piece of it. A systematic approach is used and data are collected using methods and tools that meet accepted standards. So something to think about is data collection. Are you going to have access as a DNP student to the data collection? So whether it's charts, electronic charts, is it, be thinking about that with your project of what kind of data are you collecting? Is it with patients, are you going to be able to get that survey? That type of thing. Be thinking about that. And then expected outcomes are defined and measured. So outcomes are huge. So when you're thinking about an intervention or your PICO question, so PICO, again, is your population, intervention, comparison, and outcome. So your intervention, when you're thinking about that, what would be outcomes that would change because of your intervention? And can you measure those outcomes? That's the hard one sometimes. You know what you want, but are they measurable? So that's something to think about. Project is conducted according to ethical principles. In DNP 830, you will go through what's called CITI training, C-I-T-I training. And this is basically, and you do it within the course. It's not an extra training. It's within the course. It's actually an assignment, I believe. But this kind of just lets you know about IRB, what IRB is, what it means to conduct research in an ethical manner. So anybody that does research with, anywhere has to go through this type of training. And then dissemination modes are professional and public. So after you are done with your project, it will automatically be published in our GCU library. And then you as a student have the option to publish in ProQuest at the end of this. And then I have recently initiated that students put together, it's a PowerPoint, one slide of a poster presentation, of what a poster presentation would look like. So that when you are done and after you've had a fabulous vacation, after you've graduated, you can go back and if you end up having a conference that you can go to and present your poster presentation, all you have to do is printed out. So that's pretty exciting when you get to that point. So this is the AAC and DNP white paper. At the very end of this PowerPoint, I have all of these references. Another really good resource for you when you start thinking about your project topics to make sure that they are appropriate for the program. And this basically talks about the same thing, having a population focus, implementing an appropriate arena or area of clinical practice, and then a plan for sustainability for these projects. The next couple slides are related to an article that I really thought was helpful in looking at a DNP final project. So it's called EC-ASPI, EC meaning Enhances, Culmination, Partnerships, Implements, Evaluation. And enhances practice outcomes, health outcomes, or healthcare policy to ultimately improve patient outcomes. So again, it needs to have that measurable outcome. And I'm not going to go through each one of these, but you can look at this article. It was really, they gave a lot of examples, and I found it to be very helpful to explain some things. So I will flip through these, and I want to get to the PICA reminders. So this again is the PICA question, which you guys, if you haven't already, you will be developing that very soon. So population. It's remember you have to have access to that population. So be thinking about that when you're thinking about your clinical sites that you're going to do your project in. And you want to really start building those relationships now. I know it seems very early in the program to be thinking about all of this. But what's unique about Green Canyon is that you're really starting your project in essence now, because you're thinking about your PICO questions, which develops into your 10 strategic points, which develops into your prospectus. So it builds. Every couple classes, you continue to build on this project. So by the time you get to your three project courses, you have a really good idea, not only of what you're doing, where you're doing it, and who you're doing it with. So it's a great platform to really get you prepared once you hit those project courses. So your PICO question, be thinking about your population. The one thing I wanted to point out were vulnerable populations. I come in contact with this a lot with students, so I wanted to bring that to your attention now. So most students' projects will go through IRB as exempt. So there's three levels of IRB: exempt, expedited, and full review. Full review will be for vulnerable populations. So what is a vulnerable population? Pregnant women, human fetuses, neonates, children in general are vulnerable, prisoners, cognitively impaired persons, students and employees, minorities, economically or educationally disadvantaged, AIDS and HIV positive subjects. That's from the IRB site that talks about vulnerable populations. So be thinking about that as a consideration when you're thinking about your project. We're really discouraging vulnerable population only because it will take you through that full IRB review, which can be very time consuming. So the next one would be intervention. And I mentioned this, that encourage utilizing existing valid and reliable tools. You are not making your own guideline in this program. You are using existing valid, reliable guidelines, tools, surveys, studies, all of those things are documents that are already out there because you're wanting to implement them. So be thinking about that. Talk about feasibility, money if that applies, clinical site, the time that it would take. A perfect example of that is somebody doing an intervention with diabetic patients. Great, right? Diabetic patients are everywhere. Great intervention, great population. However, she was measuring hemoglobin A1Cs, which you have to measure those on a 3-month basis for it to be a valid test. So be thinking about that because she's already built in a 3-month wait just for her project results. So be thinking about those time factors of what would be appropriate. And then IRB approval. So if you have a clinical site that has an IRB, you will need to get IRB approval from them, and then you would go through GCU's IRB process, which is okay as long as you plan that into your time. Comparison, usually there will be no intervention for comparison, or basically say standard of care. And the reason for that is this isn't new research. So if you were doing a true experimental study, then you would probably have a comparison in these. But for this, for purposes of this program, most of the time you won't have a comparison. And then outcomes we talked about must be measurable. And then time is the big one, feasibility with the program. So your last three courses go very fast. They are still 8 weeks, and you have deliverables almost every week. And so be thinking about that once you hit those project courses of, again, that feasibility of time with your projects. And then here's just some exemplars of some other DPI projects that have already been completed. And then here's the references that I was talking about, your AACN and then your NOMP, and Woldrup et al. For their article that I thought was really good. All right, I'm going to stop recording here.